Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Don't be afraid, it's not a bomb. Let me first, before starting my presentation, really thank you all. Thank the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Mixed, and Horoshima University for inviting us and me to represent Egypt in this eminent forum, willing to discuss, elaborate, and help countries and institutions to implement the Sustainable Development Goals, especially in education. Let me, before starting my presentation again, tell you this is, you will see it is, you know, the title is Creative Egypt. And in order to have a creative Egypt without having a good education and have a new citizen who are creative enough, initiator, we will not have this brand real. There is something here that I can show you. It's like a bomb. But I keep it now, and maybe we can discuss by the end of my talk why I brought this bomb with me to Japan. It has passed all security measures, no problem, don't be afraid. And let me again tell you a funny story. I think in Japan, you are very well organized. You have all your, we have all our presentations in English and Japanese. You have it all? Yes. I think there's no need that I should present my presentation because you have it. But let me discuss with you quickly what we are going to do. In fact, my presentation today is going in line with the Education Development Forum and Sustainable Development Goals. And let me talk to you about a real case, you know, data from the field. You know, sometimes the professors, I'm one of them, usually have tendency to sometimes make more philosophy and get to ideal issues that on the field, teachers, professors, managers cannot do it. And really, I would like to thank Professor Ushida for preparing the audience with what are the SDGs. And I think at the beginning, you have asked me to prepare something about the comparative between different countries. And finally, you decided to do it. And thank you very much for your presentation and for information that will facilitate my target. I'll go directly to I have to do this. You know, SDGs is recently approved since 2015, started 2016. And let me, you know, we don't have enough data concerning the SDGs, especially the SDG 4. About education in Egypt yet, and maybe in some countries. But let me talk to you about the Millennium Goals, which give some indication to that. Millennium Goals, for the Millennium Goals, it was the goal number 2, you know, and there were some indicators. And let me go quickly, what was the achievement in Egypt and the progress about the second Millennium Development Goals. If you look at the net enrollment rate in primary, it was about 75 in 2011, and it unfortunately it declined to 91% in 2014. It's far from MDGs. If you look at the net enrollment in preparatory education, it was 70. It increased it to 82. It's good. But again, it's far from the target of MDG. If you look at the pupils who finished the primary education, it was 79, and it declined to 75. Yet, we are not far from the goal, and literacy rate, it dropped to about 8%. But if you compare it about, this is the age group 15-24, but if you go to over 60, you will find that the literacy rate is 65%, which is really very difficult. But there is here a possibility to remove completely the illiteracy in Egypt in the younger ages. Following the SDGs, Egypt has developed what we call the Egypt Vision 2030. You know, if we look at it, it has different components. Started from the economic development, environment, energy, urban development, health, transparency, and justice, knowledge and innovation, economic development, environment, and education is number four. Let us go quickly about our vision in education 2030. It's a high quality education and the training system for all, and it should be available without discrimination within an efficient, sustainable, and flexible institution and framework. Every word of this vision is, has different components for implementation. Second is to provide the necessary skills for students and the trainees to think creatively. This is why we have Creative Egypt, and to be empowered technically and technologically, and contributing to the development of a proud, creative, responsible, and competitive citizen who accepts diversity and differences and the proud of his or her country, which is what we call character building, and this is why we came to Japan to import their system of education. To give you an idea about the dimension of our system, we have 20 million students in the pre-university education between private and public. We have 53,000 schools. We have about 500,000 classrooms. We have more than a million and a quarter teachers. We have 365,000 administrative staff. It's a huge system. If you look at their distribution, unfortunately it's at 14-15, you look that we have a very young generation in Egypt. We are a young country. If you look at the percentage of population, you will find that more than 50% is under the age of 24. This is very important for our discussion. What is the perception of Egyptians for education? The UN has conducted a survey recently in 2014 with Basira. Basira is a statistical center and the studies, and about what is considered as the first priority for families in Egypt. And among the 17,000, 78% said good education is the first priority. And when they said them, when we analyze the segments of the survey about age level, education, and residence, and the social class, again, good education is the first priority for all the subgroups. When you ask the Egyptians about what is their worry, 76% said that not being able to give their children good education. This is their main source of worry. This is a real bomb, which is the demographic bomb. If you look here, at the beginning of 90, the demographic increase was 1.6%. In the 2000s, it was 1.75. By the end of 2000, it was 1.8, and now is 2.6. What does it mean? If you look, for example, in this funny statistics, in 1995, in 1950, the number of births in Egypt was equal to the number of births in France. In 77, Egypt has the same number as Italy and France. 2000, you know, we added Spain. And in 2012, we added the UK. And in 2014, we added Sweden. It means that, you know, the new birth in Egypt in 2014 equals the births of five countries. What does it mean for us? It means we need 100 southern classes for the grade from 1 to 6. It means 7,000 schools. It means 20 billion Egyptian pounds. And again, do we have the land availability? The challenge is too huge. However, the government started to work on that, and we called a medium term plan from 2016 to 2020. And there are three, for education, there are three main strategic goals: to provide educational opportunities and access for students, for all, and to enhance the quality with reference to international standards. And the third one is to enhance the competitiveness of the education system. We can go quickly about some of the persisting challenges and how can the government is being handling these challenges. We have a very high rate density of classes. We have some classes with 70 students per class. And now there are some expanding and building new classes. There is a lack of basic leadership and teaching skill. Now there is training, especially with the Professional Academy for Teachers, and in cooperation with national and international organization. There is an inequity due to socioeconomic status in some region. And there are now some program of social inclusion in both public and the private schools, and especially in the technical and vocational schools. And we have the poor relevance with labor market, and this is what we are trying to do, is to bridge the gap between the skills required by industry and what is being taught in the schools. Very quickly, some of the going reform, we will go by the pillars, the well-known pillars of education: access, new building schools, government and you know, either by the government or PPP, public-private partnership, grants, loans. The General Authority for Building Schools is now, the target is to build 40,000 classrooms per year, and to improve the school environment. When we go about the quality, which is the worry of everyone in Asia, we have two main categories: capacity building of teachers through professional academy, school business training, and professional training communities, and the capacity for leadership, especially principals and the regions. And we have two programs running on, and especially what we need to do to reform the regulation and rules in Egypt. If we continue about the quality, the curricular reform based on international reference, and for the time being, they have the UK and Singapore for the topic and subject matters. The evaluation system reform, especially for the general and technical education certificate, exam and assessment in Egypt is a major issue. The expansion of STEM school is science and science, technology, and engineering and mathematics school, and we have a very successful story in this issue, but it still is a pilot because we have only about a dozen of school. Learning environment development, you know, and we need to amend and change and upgrade and the rules and the regulation in Egypt, and introducing the new technology in education, and finally the educational activities, which is culture, physical, etc. And I think we will talk more in details when we will talk about our experience with Japan. When we talk about equity, inclusion of students of special needs in public and the private schools, and it includes as well the development of infrastructure for them, supporting students at risk, especially poor and single mother supported family, school feeding program. At my time of education, we have school feeding for all schools. It has been disappeared. Now it's become back gradually. Classroom for multiple intelligence and individual differences. We don't call them anymore slow learners. We call them multiple intelligence and individual differences. And the famous idea of community school, especially in rural area, where students are not able to go to schools. When we talk about relevance, the competency-based approach for teaching and learning it started to be applied. We have some sort of standardization of 4 technical level professionals to be integrated in the curricula, building 100 technical school within factories, increasing the weight of industry-based student training. And I'm happy that we have the JICA consultant who are working in Egypt now for technical education and basic education among us today. Adapting life approach for teaching and learning in STEM school and international cooperation. Let me now go to the second part of my presentation, which is having all these difficulties and the challenges, would it be possible to do something, I think, through international cooperation? We have international cooperation with different countries, but let me concentrate, because we are in Japan, in the cooperation with Japan. And in Japan, actually, we have what we called Egypt-Japan Education Partnership. It has been, this education partnership has been declared and signed by the two leaders of the country in February 2016, based on a study conducted by JICA in 2015-2016 in a 2 pre-pilot schools, that had found that the school education in Egypt puts more attention on the subject study rather than on the whole child development. Because in Egypt, we have a high pressure on the students that they should have good notes, good marks, and they should go to the university. This is the ultimate objective of any family in Egypt. And during the presidential visit to Japan in 2016, the two leaders have signed this education partnership, and it essentially aims at introducing the essence of Japanese style whole child education, what we called nowadays Tokatsu and Tokatsu Plus, and the school the school management. Let me maybe go into a more detail. And I'll go quickly, and maybe for questions and answer, if you have any details to be asked, we will answer. The main objective of the EJAP is the empowerment of Egyptian youth, and through the introduction of the Japanese-style education. And the initiative has 3 main components. The first one is the human resources development program. And this human resource development program is to increase the number of Egyptian students and trainees who would come to Japan in order to be trained or have their PhDs or master degree. And the agreement is to dispatch at least 2,500 Egyptians for the next 5 years. The second component is the Tokatsu, or the Egypt-Japan school model. And this type of school is to introduce the Japanese style education in Egypt, and we call it Tokatsu Plus, because Tokatsu is only for the primary education. We added to the primary education the kindergarten, and this is why we call it Tokatsu Plus. Promotion of Tokatsu Plus in Egypt. Model summer school to which the Japanese style education will be applied. Capacity building for teachers and instructions. Improved our school management, which is a major issue in Egypt. And promotion of the physical education and the music as a school subject in Egypt. It's not extracurricular, but it should be part of the curricula. And promoting learning through playing practice at nurseries and kindergartens. And finally, the cooperation in technical education. The third component, and which is the jewel of the cooperation between Egypt and Japan, is the promotion of EJAST, Egypt-Japan University of Science and Technology, and this is the first Japanese, full-fledged Japanese university outside Japan. Maybe we can go a little bit more in detail about the EJAP. And it, you know, we expect that this model, you know, will follow our child law in 2018 and other sustainable development goal in Egypt. And through this education in EGS, students will be able to work with classmates and to be good at teamwork and observe rules, take responsibility by playing their roles, have a passion for their school, be involved in activities voluntarily, and not being told to do that, undertake tasks with carrying its objective in mind, complete the tasks with having fun. Finally, what we aim is to have good members of the society. And I used to, telling my colleagues in experts from Japan that if this is the Japanese system, I have been raised on the Japanese system, but 50 years ago. The school time, it will be a full-time, single-shift-day schooling, because in Egypt we have some schools because of the dynasty that it has two shifts, and it starts from kindergarten until the preparatory or maybe in primary schools. It will have, for the time being, EGS will have a special status in Egypt. It means that they will have a special management for that. And because of different problems, the maximum number of students will be 36 in one class, and they will have two teachers for the kindergarten and 36 students in one class for primary and preparatory and secondary school. For the curricula, because this is a very sensitive issue in some countries, we will not touch the curricula as such. The curricula will remain the Egyptian curricula, and all the activities will be added and integrated in the program. And schools will use English and Arabic as instructional language. This is the outline. I think we don't need to go into details. All the activities that will be done in the class and in the school, starting by the, for example, the class coordinator every day, the cleaning of the class, the student discussion, the class event, etc. You know, everything is integrated in this model. The target, we had two pilot schools in 2015-16. Actually, we added another 10. We have 12 pilot schools in 2016-2017. And now we are building 45 new schools, and we are rehabilitating 55 existing schools, and 100 schools will start next September. And the 1 year later, 18-19, we will have 200. And there will be a scaling up strategy after validating the model and overcome all difficulties that we have. This is part of the activities that is being implemented now in Egypt, which, you know, everyone is talking about cleaning the classroom. Yes, there was some resistance from the students first, after that teachers and families. But I think now it's become popular and everyone is happy to do that. Class discussion. In Egypt, we used to have, you know, what we called a class representative, but in Egypt, the class representative was for the whole year. We used to choose one, and he's responsible for the class for all year. Now, there is one, but I think every day they have a representative. Why? Because it's part of the practice to be a leadership, you know, to learn the leadership in when they are very young. Now we will go to the jewel of our cooperation, which is the Egypt-Japan University of Science and Technology. It's the basic concept is this is a partnership government-to-government between Egypt and Japan. It's a leading university serving Egypt, Middle East, and Africa. It's a role model for other Egyptian higher education sector because we have some difficulties in higher education sector. It's a research-oriented, graduate-focused. It's a Japanese-style approach. It means a project-based learning. It is unique academic programs. It's, you know, we don't adopt in this university classical program, but it's mostly multidisciplinary. For the time being, it has two faculties: engineering and applied sciences, business and international community. They have 8 engineering and science program. I not mention them. You have it in your paper. And we have now planned 2 programs to start next year. This university has already started since 2009, and now we have many graduates from master and doctor degrees, and undergraduate will start next September. The model is very important because this is a unique model where both government are involved. We have supporting universities from Japan. As you see, we have two kinds of universities, what we call the coordination consortium of those universities, and we have what we call Japanese, supporting a consortium. We have an essential component in the university, which is industry from Egypt and from Japan. And for the government, we have all of them. We have the MOFA, MIXT, MITAI, JICA, METRO, JETRO, etc. All the governmental agencies are involved. I'll not explain this one. This is a summary of what I have said. All. And the objective of putting this slide before ending my talk is to say that we have a very good, valid partner in supporting all what I have said, which is JICA. And you see here, for example, all this activity has been done by JICA. And its teams, experts, etc. I can recognize that during the last 2 years, or even before the 2 years, when we were negotiating the EJUST issue, we have been pushing hard, Egyptians, on JICA side and Japanese side, thanks to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, thanks to the Ministry of Finance, thanks to the Ministry, to MIX, but our main player in the field is JICA. And I would end my talk by thanking JICA. And this Creative Egypt, if you allow me, we'll go to JICA. And can I ask Dr. Ishihara to come and take on the stage?
石原先生お願いいたします。
Dr. 石原 please take the floor. Go up.
Yes, yes. This is. And now you can have your phone, and you can open it whenever you can.
Please use a microphone.